why they're in a different spot today. I know I'm often in a different spot, but today I'm in a hotel in London, and I wanted to talk to you about burnout. Really a subject that is very close to my heart, for not the best reasons really, in that in 2015 I went to work one day, and I remember looking down at my computer. So at that point I was a primary school head teacher. So I went into my office, looked at my computer. It was a proper old, you know, everyone's got a laptop these days, haven't they? This is a proper tower, you know. I remember looking at the tower where the on-off button was, and just being completely unable to switch it on. The capability to do that had seemed to have fallen away. And you know, we all have a moment like that, don't we? But on this particular occasion, I literally could not, I couldn't do it. I just couldn't push through that resistance. It just wasn't completely impossible. And I remember, you know, walking out of work, walking out of my office, went to the main school office. They took one look at me and said, you might need to go home, Clare, you don't look very well. So off I went. Well, I actually went to the doctors, and unfortunately I was diagnosed, couldn't think of the word then, I was diagnosed with depression, which meant it took me, well, I was off sick from work for a year. And I hear people saying, you know, I burnt out this weekend. And maybe they did, but my experience of it was not a weekend. it was a whole year of being off sick from work before I actually resigned, and then I would say years of healing. And that's not, trust me, for the want of trying. There was a lot of it about. So I am passionate now about this not being the outcome for other women like me. And when I say women like me, I'm talking really about women who have carried the mantle. I feel like it's like the Olympic torch, and carried the mantle of being high achieving or identify as that. And I think it's probably worth getting an understanding of yourself as being that high achieving woman, because it's really funny that I speak to a few women at the moment. I'm really you know, working on my Thriving Woman approach, and I'm inviting women to join the program. And what's really funny is I keep messaging people who I think are the actual perfect people for this program, and they're like, oh, I'm very flattered that you think I'm a high achieving woman. And I just find that just really interesting. And maybe, you know, just sharing a little bit about what I've seen about burnout, really, as the years have gone on, my ideas about it have really changed. So I never thought it was about work. When I was not specifically that job that I was doing. So I was a primary school head teacher. I had just moved jobs. I was two terms into, so I'd worked at that school from September till the end of March before I walked out. I never went back. And I was, you know, I wanted that job more than anything in the world. I wanted to be a head teacher. I also wanted to be a head teacher of a big school, because that's where you go when you've been the head teacher of a small school, it turns out. And if you're not watching in the UK, being a head teacher is a leader, school leader, but like a principal of a primary school. So that was a 3 to 11 age range school for me. So back when it first happened, when I first realised I'd burnt out, and it took a while to kind of realise that, because of the misdiagnosis from the NHS and me going down that depression path for quite a long time, very unhelpfully actually, by, you know, thinking a lot about depression, guess what? I started to feel lower and lower than probably I would have done if I'd left that one behind, or not been on that journey of exploration. Anyway, that could be a whole other video, couldn't it? It probably will be one day. So I didn't think it was work, but I did think it was my level of stuff I was doing in the world. So I had recently split from my husband, My children have always had extremely busy lives in theatre, television, and all, you know, film, all the other things that children do, like football and dancing, and a lot of ferrying about and a lot of coordination. So my life was already very busy. Within a few months of splitting from my husband, I took a promotion, and alongside that, I was doing a lot of online dating. I was doing a lot of drinking, going out on a Saturday night, starting at Wetherspoons, not good. And you know, I was doing a lot of salsa dancing. I just had this ridiculous level of stuff going on in my life. It's a miracle, actually. I mean, I wasn't sleeping because my sleep had completely deteriorated by the time I burnt out. But it was I didn't actually have time to sleep. That was part of the problem. It's always those two issues with sleep, isn't there? Not enough time, and not seem to have lost the ability. And back then I would have said, look, I had too much going on. That's why I was stressed. That's why I had too much. Now, but why? I mean, like, let's take that down a layer. Why did I have so much going on? What was that about? Why did I feel the need to have this ridiculously jam-packed life? Now, for a long time, and I would say, I'd still say it like this, I talked about control. So there was... There's definitely this sense, and maybe you can relate to this, of trying to get control of the outside world, like whack-a-mole. If I can just hold down all these things, I can feel okay. I can, you know, if I can hold down the little heads and they don't keep bobbing, of course they don't. They keep bobbing up, don't they? And then you're continually whack-a-moling with the hammer. So I feel like I should start a group called Control Freaks Anonymous. Maybe I should just do that, because I think that there's a group of us, particularly high-achieving women, who are literally trying to control everything out there in order to feel okay. And I would still say that was an element in how I'm seeing it now. So how I see it now is that right from being a little girl, my sense of self-worth was to do with achievement. Now, I remember being 9 or 10 years old, so I was at middle school, and I was in competition with a girl called Vicky. It was like, who's top of the class this week kind of thing, and we were always competing with each other, to the point of it just being like, the fact that I can still remember her name, I think, is pretty significant, really. That carried on through my academic career. And unfortunately, all the way through that academic career, I didn't know that I had an underlying issue. It's a bit like dyslexia, it's called Irlen syndrome. And I didn't really find out until my early 30s that I had this condition. So I had got through all my like O-levels at the time, A-levels, so my 16-year-old education 16, my education to 18, and then my university degree and my postgraduate certificate for teaching. I'd got through all of that, and it was actually really hard. A lot of it felt very, very hard. And of course, as this self-identified high-achieving woman, that was yet more pressure. And yet I can kind of see the thread of that running through. And then it went into my career, of course. And right from being in the classroom right at the beginning, with my first role, really, I wanted to be a head teacher. I could see some people who I wanted to emulate. I could still see some people I was led by who I never wanted to be like, because they were not my cup of tea, shall we say. And I was very, very driven. I even took a promotion when I was on maternity leave with my second child. So I was, had a two-year-old and a baby, and I was applying for promotions, which is... yeah, not good, really. And then again, you know, going for that promotion when I had just split up from my husband. And it's because I really thought that, I think like many of us, we're kind of told, well, you know, when you get there, A, you're going to feel happy. And also, you know, there's a sense that I was going to feel valuable, worthy, whatever word you want to attach to that, unconsciously, the drive to fill that hole. And it did feel like a hole when I think about it, and I've spoken to other women who explain it in a very similar way. It feels like there is a hole within us to be filled. Now, that hole isn't really there. That hole is created by all that conditioning that we experience, the things that we've learned from the people around us, you know, from that critical treat and mean, keep and keen parenting that I talk about, from you know, from society's expectations of us as a generation of women who, you know, had those opportunities handed to us, and how very dare we not fulfil them. Now, I think that the kind of where the extra layer came in for me that really tipped me over the edge to burnout was that when I got to that final point in my career, so I was 40, how old was I? 44 when I burnt out. I was on my second headship, so I was pretty doing very well career wise. And I got to this position where I was in this very big school with 500 children, which in the north of England is a pretty big primary school. We don't really go much bigger than that. I had a big private childcare facility as well, like before and after school club. It was a big school with a lot of staff and a lot of issues, etc. And within there's always an initial buzz, isn't there, when we reach that promotion point, like it's like a bit of a dopamine hit, I think. It was a very short time after arriving, probably a matter of maybe a month or so, maybe a couple of months, that hole was there again. And I was thinking, well, there must be something else. Then I even started seeing a life coach, not a life coach like me, but she was fab. But we ended up exploring what I might do after. And really interestingly, I've still got photographs of the bits of paper, because they actually said things about helping other people and that kind of thing. So really interesting that I've ended up, that's where I've ended up in the end. And then, because there was, I think, this unconscious sense that, oh, the career's not it then. It's not the career, that's not where I'm going to get my feeling of self-worth. Then that energy was redirected into online dating. Ooh, an awful lot. Tried to get my self-worth there. And into all these other activities that I was doing. And of course then I just had a lot to think about and a lot to do and became exhausted. Now, I don't know where you are. I mean, I really hope you're not at the burnout point of this journey. But I think it's helpful to just start to go, oh, hang on a minute. What is this for? You know? I was on a networking event this morning, and there was a woman talking about a particularly difficult position she was in with a business that she's been kind of left holding the baby, literally, with this business that, from what I could hear from what she was saying, she didn't really want the business, she wants to sell it. And I just thought, why? But she's trying to do things with it before she sells it. And I just thought, why don't you just sell it? just sell it. Just sell the damn thing. But of course that doesn't occur to us if we are, we've got to tick all the boxes first, haven't we? Like, as high achieving women, everything's got to be right. And we can't let go of that. I am going to start Control Freaks Anonymous, I think. That's maybe what it should all be about. That we've got to keep at it. And we can't stop until we feel like we've got all those little heads on the whack-a-mole game to stay down. And we never ever will have that. And while ever we are, we've lost who we truly are, and we're trying to feel that in the outside world, when really this you know, the universal intelligence, peace, love, wisdom, consciousness, whatever you want to call it, that we truly are, is already there. That it's not, we don't have to go and get it from outside of us. But if we, whenever we think we do, we are going to be exhausted. So I hope that's helped you to see that really, you know, because so often burnout, we talk about it as if it's a thing coming in from the outside world. And of course, when we've put ourselves into all these positions of not saying no and having no boundaries and not no work-life integration and none of that, because we're trying to feel this thing, because we're trying to get to this feeling of self-worth, I do think that that's it. And I think it's why it's just such a huge issue right now, because there's so much coming in about what this perfect, you know, life looks like, whether that's what we might see on social media or whatever. There's just so much driving us towards this thing that when we get there, we just, it's just not it, and it never will be it if it's from the outside world. And that doesn't mean we can't create things and have businesses and careers and all of those things and have an amazing time, but if we think that is going, you know, it's back to that equation, when I have X position in life or a number of clients or amount of money or whatever, I will feel Y feeling, that's it. And that is the driver behind burnout, because we keep getting to X and we think, we go, oh, Y's not here, feeling's not here, it's not here. Oh, I best do some more then. I'll need to do some more. I need to do some more. And then maybe I'll find why. And we never do. So we just keep going to the point of exhaustion. And I speak to a lot of business owners, actually, who've realised before they got there. And they've gone, whoa, hang on a minute. And they've stepped away before burnout. Unfortunately, I wasn't that savvy. I don't want that to happen to you. If you would like to explore the Thriving Woman approach, then please do reach out. You know where I am. There's some information below the video, and please do, you know, like this video, subscribe and find out more about what I'm sharing. So take care, my darling. Lots of love. Thank you so much for watching.